So that was the end of any idea of using progesterone as a contraceptive, but the idea was well known and published. What progesterone was then used in medicine, however, was for some of its other uses. Namely, it is produced by women during the menstrual cycle, but generally during the second part of the menstrual cycle, in preparation for in case they got pregnant, in which case secretion would then continue for 9 months to inhibit further ovulation and further fertilization, and also to maintain the proper environment in the uterus for the development after implantation of the embryo and the blastocyst and so on. So it's used for menstrual disorders to this day, and it was used for infertility, which is ironic. But there are women who get pregnant without difficulty but cannot maintain a pregnancy to term because they do not produce enough progesterone, and therefore the uterine environment, let's say, is not optimal, and they suffer spontaneous abortion. And that is, particularly at that time, was one of the treatments for habitual abortion, spontaneous habitual abortion in women. They were then given progesterone by injection in order to offset it. In a number of cases, of course, they did so. And one man who did quite a bit of work in this field was a clinician named John Rock at Harvard. So there you have Rock. And then, so that was this. In 1951, we synthesized this compound norethindrone because we wanted to develop new drugs, of course, for Syntax. And we thought this was an interesting one. I mean, Syntax was in the progesterone business and the supplier of the raw material to pharmaceutical companies. But what if we could make a proprietary drug, which would be a much more remunerative thing, and one that would have a real function which progesterone did not fulfill, namely, to be orally active. And that's why we made this compound, and I indicated how, and it turned out to be orally active and the most potent progestational compound known at that time, much more potent than the natural hormone. So we then, even though we were a very small company that had no biology or clinic, we then farmed it out to send it to many different biologists. Quite a number of them published then on our work. And we also sent it to Gregory Pinkus, who at that time was in Worcester Foundation, was a recognized biologist in that area. suggestion he might be interested in this. He, in fact, was not the first one to publish on this, even though people think he was, but he was, or claim he was. No, not even claim. Ignore the fact that he was not. But that's sort of besides the point. We sent it also to the National Cancer Institute, and that's where it was first published. But what they all confirmed was the compound was active orally, and then carried it through rabbits, guinea pigs, to monkeys. And the very first clinical experiment, on the clinical efficacy of norethindrone was done by a man named Tyler, T-Y-L-E-R, who is now dead, who at that time was working at UCLA, and he was medical director of Planned Parenthood. But he was interested in various applications of progesterone. Pinkus was interested in really I wouldn't say rediscover, because of course he knew about it, but extending and improving the basic idea of Haberland. And that's perfectly okay. In fact, that's what science is all about. You build on your predecessors. But I've never forgiven him is that this book of his that has 1,600 references, and quite a number of them are totally unimportant, has not a mention of Haberland. If you look in the index, where there are hundreds and hundreds of names, not only doesn't have any chemists, you might say, all right, he's a biologist, he doesn't believe in chemistry. But here was a biologist, who did it, and he's not there. And that bothers me. And therefore, calling Pinkus solely the father of the pill is inappropriate. Calling him a father is totally appropriate. But he was a key contributor, but not the only one. And something came way before him, that was Haberland. And then what came then was the chemist making an orally active compound, and then and then the first clinician, and then was John Rock, interesting enough. So he clearly would be the midwife. And I think it is appropriate to call Pinkus a father, maybe even the father, but he certainly didn't play the maternal role. He needed that to, and that is the one that I've been describing with Hirn in this book. And then the brutal details and the interesting patent details, because a year and a half, and we published our stuff right away, patented right away, 4 weeks or 5 weeks after we published this. We published it, and I mean completed it, on October 15, 1951, as a real birthday. And by November, something like 22 and so on, we'd already filed the patent application. And in March the following year, already published it, the first report, and then a little bit later, a very detailed one in Journal of American Chemical Society. A year and a half later, after that, another chemist, Colton, at G.D. Searle, which was a much larger pharmaceutical company, was a real pharmaceutical company near Chicago, much larger than ours, he worked there, made a very close analog of it. So close that if you, some people would call it, like me, call it a pro-drug. That is, it is a compound that is different from the actual active compound, but if you put it into the body, it gets transferred, transformed into the original compound, and that's the active one. And in fact, it is a compound that the double bond is only in a different position. And when it's exposed to acid, in other words, the stomach acid, gets transformed into our compound. But that, of course, circumvented our patent. A perfectly legal is so, so I'm not talking that there are any shenanigans about it. I don't mean that at all. But that was a year and a half later. But he worked for the company that supported much of Pinkus's work and sent it also to Pinkus, of course, considerably after we did. And Pinkus selected that for the first, for his work. And that was, again, perfectly appropriate, yet financial and other relations with them, and there was nothing inappropriate about it. That's what you would pick.